report on ongoing joint work with Dan Sachs, a very good graduate student, and my better half, Betsy Stevenson, who is this year serving as a member of the Council of Economic Advisors. And what I'm going to do is talk about subjective well-being. And the first question really is, how would you go about measuring that? It's the question that Larry raised, and it's a good question. We're going to do the simplest thing you can do, ask people. And so what is it we're going to ask people? In this literature, there's an array of different types of questions you might ask people. The standard one that people use is the satisfaction ladder. Here is a ladder representing the ladder of life. At the very top of the ladder is the best possible life for you. At the bottom of the ladder, I want you to think about the worst possible life for you. That ladder's got 10 rungs. Which rung of that ladder do you think you're currently on? Right. And so I'm sort of, right now I'm on the 8th rung of that ladder. I'm an 8 out of 10, I'd say, on the ladder of life. In countries in which they don't have ladders, they have to talk about the mountain of life instead. There's a lot of work analyzing instead of life satisfaction, all things considered. How satisfied are you with your life? Happiness. So one of the mistakes I think economists have made is we've talked about this whole area as being happiness. These are actually all different measures. We're asking different questions, so we're getting different data back. So all of these I think of as being measures of subjective well-being, people reporting on their subjectively experienced lives. They're not necessarily happiness, but happiness, we can say taken all together, how would you say things are these days? Would you say you're very happy, pretty happy, or not too happy? And then all the way, we have now actually very new data on this. Did you experience the following feeling for a lot of the day yesterday? So this is sort of like point-in-time happiness rather than thinking about things. You know, did you experience happiness, enjoyment, anger, sadness, stress, or worry? For those of you who are trying to both get a master's degree and work, some of these might seem a little familiar. When I talk to my friends who are psychologists, they talk about these as being different constructs. And in particular, they talk about this sort of the stuff that's at the evaluative end, where you're being invited to think about your life as a whole. Think about the last 20 years, think about the next 20 years. Think not just about happiness, but you know all the things that go into describing how satisfied you are with your life. To the purely affective, and the most affective question you could ask would be, how happy are you right now? Right? And so that's actually a very hard question to put into surveys in a meaningful way, so this is the best attempt at that. So most of the work economists have done has been actually on the more evaluative measures. Partly that's just data. We don't yet have a lot of affective data. And what I'm going to do for much of the talk is I'm going to talk mostly about the satisfaction ladder, but most of what I'm going to tell you is also equally true when I look at life satisfaction or happiness as well. And I'm going to bring in different data sets that are going to talk about each of those a little bit. So you'll see I don't think it's the different questions that are going to lead to different answers. So what is it that I want to do? The most natural question for an economist when thinking about subjective well-being would be to think about the relationship between that and economic indicators. And so the motivating question here is, what's the relationship between subjective well-being and income? But in fact, there's not just one relationship between subjective well-being and income. There are several. You could look within a country at a point in time. We could compare rich people to poor people. Are rich people happier than poor people? There's a different question we could ask, which is we could look between countries. We could say, are rich countries like the United States on average happier than poor countries like Burundi? Or we could follow countries through time. As countries get richer, do they get happier? Or finally, we could put together a panel following different countries through time and ask, did the countries that had the biggest bump to economic growth get the biggest bump to their happiness? Okay. So the starting point in much of this literature, what I want to do now is give you something of a history of the literature and the broader context in which I'm trying to paint. And then I'll actually talk through some of the results from some of my earlier papers, and then we'll go to the stuff that's new as well. So the background here really is the history of economic thinking about happiness begins with something called the Eastland Paradox. The Eastland Paradox came about in the 1970s, and it's still widely regarded as a conventional view. So if you pick up Oprah magazine, as you'll want to do, you might hear things like money doesn't make you happy. And that's because Oprah magazine hasn't been reading the economic literature over recent decades. So the Eastland Paradox, really, it's not a theory. It was a set of statistical observations. It was a claim that when you looked within a country at a point in time, rich people were happier than poor people. But when Eastland went to look between countries, he found no evidence that rich countries were happier than poor countries. Notice I was very careful about what I just said there. I didn't say he found that rich countries weren't happier than poor countries. I said he found no evidence that rich countries were happier than poor countries. He found no evidence that as countries got richer, they got happier, and he didn't really look at international panel data. So the paradox here, as he saw it, was why is it rich people are happier than poor people, but rich countries aren't happier than poor countries? And the way to reconcile those would be to think about something like relative income mattering, or interpersonal comparisons are important, or keeping up with the Joneses, right? So if what matters is how wealthy you are relative to the people around you, then if everyone in a country gets richer, then no one gets happier, right? Because our relative positions don't change at all. If you believe that that's true, relative income determines well-being, there are radical implications for economics. The first of them is we should just give up on economic growth. What a dreadful idea. All that we're doing is we're stressing each other out, making everyone richer, but making no one relatively richer, so therefore making nobody happier. Okay? It's actually a view that's still taken quite seriously in some circles. Less so within economics, but certainly very seriously within psychology. So this view that further economic development would not raise the well-being of a population is, I think, somewhat embarrassing to some. It's actually quite difficult to walk into a village in Burundi and see a mother who may have just lost a child, see a village without running water, to see a family ravaged by disease, to see places with life expectancies in the 40s, and just say, you know what, you don't really need economic growth, it's not going to make you happier. And so this led to a revised view that what mattered instead was, well, sure, income matters, but it only matters up to a point, right? Income matters until you reach, until your basic needs are met. And once your basic needs are met, then bang, we're back into Easterland land where it's all about relative income comparisons. Okay, so this was the view that, therefore, there's some point of income beyond which we're satiated. And the view was maybe this was like $15,000, maybe it was $10,000, maybe it was $20,000, but once you've got that basic level of income, so income matters, you've got to raise people to the point where their basic needs are met, food and shelter, and then beyond that, further income's not going to help. Now there's actually not, let me add this, so relative income matters here for rich countries, and absolute income matters for poor countries. So again, the policy implications would be, sure, we ought to try for development in the third world, but for those of us in the first world, economic development is still a zero-sum game and not worth pursuing. The other thing is, think about the implications here for labor supply. If what matters to me is my income relative to yours, every time you get rich, you bum me out a little, right? It's kind of hedonic pollution. Every time you do well, you make me worse off. And just like when we study externalities, when someone's polluting the environment for others, making their lives worse, we think that what we should do is tax them, a Pigouvian tax on that hedonic pollution, right? And so this suggests, again, if you believe that what matters is relative income, then you also believe that we should have incredibly high income taxes. Because every time someone earns extra income, they're bumming a whole bunch of other people out, and we want to try and tax them and stop them from doing too much of that. So that's sort of the evolutionist view, and what I want to do in this talk is actually convince you of a completely different view. I want to show you data which suggests within a country at a point in time, rich people are happier than poor people. When you compare countries in roughly equal measure, rich countries are in fact happier than poor countries. And when you follow countries through time, as they get richer, they get happier at just about the rate you'd expect. And also when I'm going to put together the panel data, we're going to find that as countries, the countries that get the richest the fastest get the biggest bump in happiness as well. So none of this is a theoretical claim about any of this stuff. The point here is this is a debate that's basically all based on four statistical stylized facts, and I'm just going to go through purely empirically and question what those stylized facts are. Okay. So what's new here, I'm going to talk you through this. The comparisons between rich and poor people and rich and poor countries is from some earlier work. I'm going to walk you through that work and show you that. What's new here that people haven't seen, that I haven't, this paper is unpublished, it's published, it's not even public, I don't think. What's new is looking at what's happening within a country through time. So as a country gets richer, do its people get happier? Okay, so I'm going to focus a fair bit on that part of things. So that's where we're at. Let me tell you a little about what I am and aren't going to do, and I'm more than happy to entertain these issues when we come to the Q&A. In fact, let's make it a discussion if you find me being unclear, wrong, Australian, then please do interrupt as we go. We'll also leave time at the end. But the first thing I'm going to do is notice that this debate is entirely a debate about stylized facts. No one's doing careful causal analysis of whether income causes happiness. They're talking about the correlation between income and happiness. I know we teach people to do better than that, but it's equally true, I think, in policy debates we see all the time the first order stylized facts really inform how people think about the policy questions. So my goal here is just to get the stylized facts right. Later on, someone cleverer can come back and figure out what the causal analyses look like. And the second thing is, again, because what I'm going to do is there's an accepted body of empirical literature that claim to be a set of stylized facts. I'm going to attack those purely empirically. So I'm not going to, along the way, sit back and stroke my beard and talk about what does happiness mean or what is a good life. I think we're having drinks after. So we're having drinks. I've got my leather elbow patches. And that seems exactly the right time for indulging those deeper questions, but that's also where I lack much expertise as well. So that's sort of where I'm going. Here's sort of the background why I'm doing this analysis. And this is where I'm going to slip into causal language, but I'm going to do that occasionally, and I'm a sinner, and I will sin. So why is it that people are interested in these stylized facts? Well, first of all, if you had the simplest view of the world, the one that someone like Larry would teach you, it would be that your well-being is a function of the log of your income. Okay? And life's as simple as that, right? And you've all heard economists say, more income, stuff's better, right? More money, less problems. We say it would rise in the log because we think that as you get richer, each extra dollar doesn't make you that much more happier, right? And, you know, log catches the intuition that a 10% rise in income would have the same impact on well-being for anyone, whether rich or poor. It requires more dollars for a rich person, that seems roughly right. Okay, and so if you believe that view, then you would think the comparisons between rich and poor people, which I call a within estimator, should be similar to the comparisons between within and poor countries, what I call a between estimator, and that should be similar to the comparisons of a country as it gets richer through time, what we call a time series estimator, right? If instead you had the view that what mattered was relative income, then you would think that within a country at a point in time, rich people are happier than poor people, so the within estimator is big and positive. But if you compared rich and poor countries, within a country, the average person is as rich as the average person. And that's as equally true in Burundi as it is in the United States. And so therefore you would think there was no reason to believe that rich countries are happier than poor countries, so the between estimator would be zero. And you'd also think that through time, if you got richer and your neighbors got richer, no one got happier. So therefore, you think that the time series effect would also be zero. Okay. And then another thing you could think about would be adaptation. This would be the view that what matters is not your income compared to your friends and neighbors, but what matters is your income compared to maybe what you were earning a few years ago. Okay. Well, if that's what matters, then people who've been rich for a long time shouldn't actually be any happier than people who've been poor for a long time. Both of us adapted to our status. If you look at what happens across countries, rich countries have been rich for a long time. The US has been rich for a long time. Burundi's been poor for a long time. So those countries, their populations should have fully adapted. So that tells you that between comparisons, rich countries should not be happier than poor countries. And then what happens through time, well, if a country quickly gets rich, people will be happy for a while and then they'll adapt. So if you look over short time periods, rich, you'll get happier, but over longer time periods, that'll sort of go away. And so this sort of motivates why what I'm going to do is look at within, between, and the time series. Okay. So where are we going? So we've done the background stuff. We've talked about what happiness means. I have no idea. I'm just going to measure it. And why we're interested in trying to figure out the relationship between income and happiness. So what we're going to do now is move on to the data. And so what I want to do is just show you quickly a little bit about what we know about the claim that within a country at a point in time, rich people are happier than poor people, okay? And everyone's favorite country is the United States. So we'll start there, and this is a Gallup poll where they ask people how happy they are. And we've got sort of, at the top row here is the poorest 10% of the United States. And you can see that poorest 10% of the United States, only 21% of them said they're very happy, and fully 26% of them said they're not too happy. Let's go all the way down to the very rich, the top 10%. Wow, it's a lot better to be rich, right? So the result never seems to surprise anyone. But so fully 53% of the rich are very happy. Here's the thing that I think is just stunning. Only 2% of the rich, and this is only the top 10%, right? only 2% of them are unhappy. So when I talk about, there's a lot of mystique about happiness data, where people even see things through a lens that's just not in the data. For instance, my colleague over at Brookings, Carol Graham, has got a book called the Puzzle of Miserable Millionaires and Happy Peasants. But look, there's no miserable millionaires. You can't find them. So, you know, this is, I think, quite a powerful relationship here. And again, I want to be careful not to say anything causally. So this is what the United States looks like. What about other countries? So I could show you a graph like this for 20 other countries, and then you'd get bored. So what I'm going to do is show you a really ugly graph, which compresses it all down to a lot of information. So what I'm going to take data from the Gallup World Poll. This is an amazing data set, and I should say I work with Gallup, so I have a conflict of interest in saying that they're amazing. But they go into every country in the world every year, and they've been doing that since 2008. And included in that is that they ask this satisfaction ladder question. Now, one of the things I'm going to do, because I'm going to report always the data, if you like it on the 0 to 10 scale, that's great, I'll report it that way. But, you know, I'm like a Z-score guy, so I'm also going to report it relative to Z-scores. And the reason I want to do that is some of the questions I'm going to show you are going to be based on a 0 to 10 scale, some are going to be based on different scales. So when I turn them into Z-scores, everything's a bit more comparable. So I'm just going to subtract the country mean, the average level of happiness, and divide by the cross-sectional standard deviation as well. Okay, so here's my ugly graph. There's a lot going on here, so let's sort of unpack it. On the horizontal axis, I have annual household income. On the vertical axis, I have a satisfaction ladder score. And if you want to see that as Z-scores, look over to the other vertical axis instead. Let's take a representative country, say the United States. And what I've done here, I'm not imposing any functional form. I'm doing a lowest regression or a non-parametric fit. Let me say it another way. I'm letting the computer figure out the line of best fit between income and subjective well-being. And so I'm letting it wiggle and waggle rather than imposing linearity. Okay. And you can see what it does is it says, well, you know, folks who are earning 16,000 are like a 6.5 out of 10, and folks who are earning 128,000 are like 7.75 out of 10, right? And it seems to go up like that. And we see different countries take different space because, of course, there's not many Americans down here. So we can see, you know, for Ethiopia, you see a similar line. The thing that I find most striking, so a few things to notice here. All of these lines are upward sloping. So in all of these countries, and these countries represent, I think, probably, these are the 25 largest countries, so probably 90% of the world's population. In all of these countries, richer people are happier than poor people. That's what the upward slope tells you. The other thing that's kind of striking about this is the relationship's remarkably similar across countries, as in the slopes are so similar. And then I'd also add, these are almost all straight lines, or close to straight lines. Remember, I'm letting the computer choose the wiggles. So the fact that these are close to straight lines, what that means is, remember the horizontal axis here is a log scale. Every time I move across, I'm doubling income. So the fact that it's a straight line actually means that reported well-being is a function of the log of income, a linear function of the log of income. And that seems to be true in all of these countries. And the slope seems to be fairly similar across all of these countries. And that slope, when I think about the Z-score scale, is about 0.35. And what I want you to do is keep your eye on that number, because recall, the Eastland paradox is fundamentally about that this comparison looks really different than when you do comparisons across countries at a point in time or within a country through time. So the income happiness gradient is about 0.35 on this thing here. So again, I do want to emphasize that the horizontal axis is a log scale here. So this isn't saying an extra dollar matters equally for everyone. It's saying that an extra 10% of income buys the same bump in happiness for just about everyone. So that's the comparisons of rich people and poor people. Let's go and do comparisons of rich countries and poor countries. And so this is where, again, the Gallup data, I have like 140 countries. So what's average income within a country? Well, that's real GDP per capita, right? And we're using real GDP per capita at purchasing power parity, which means we're taking account of the differences in the cost of living in different countries. That's what's showing on the horizontal scale, and again on a log scale. The vertical scale is life satisfaction. Now I'm showing it to you on that Z-score metric, right? And remember, the Eastland paradox says richer countries, if all that matters is relative income comparisons, richer countries should be no happier than poorer countries. So the Eastland paradox is the claim that the slope of this relationship is zero, or that there's no correlation between these variables. In fact, the correlation here is 0.8, which I find rather striking. The correlation is 0.8. I find, you know, I'm a glass half full guy, so I look at something, I'm sort of amazed at how much these things all hew to the regression line here. And let me tell you, I'm fitting two regression lines. The black line is just a pure linear regression line, And then if you're worried that linearity is missing stuff out, then the red dotted line, I'll do this throughout, is going to be a lowest fit line. So again, it'll just be a non-parametric fit. And they look remarkably similar. Okay. Let me point one other thing out. Remember the view that there was satiation, that above some level, like extra income just doesn't matter anymore? And people thought like maybe that was like $15,000. Well, that says that sure, it's okay for this to go up, but once we hit 15,000, it should turn into a flat line. That doesn't appear to be right. And in fact, if anything, it looks like, if you look at the lowest fit line, it looks like the line steepens a little bit. Okay, so there's no evidence of satiation. The final thing I want you to note here is that the regression coefficient is 0.42. And because I'm sloppy, I'm going to say that's about 0.35, right? And so that about 0.35 is awfully like that previous about 0.35. So this is exactly what this relationship would look like if you had the simple view that what matters for happiness is simply the log of income. Let me stop here and actually add one other thing. So remember Larry began the talk by saying that this was a useless research program? because he thought that happiness was inherently difficult to measure, and comparisons across cultures would be polluted by all sorts of things. And like, I had my national stereotypes, right? Like, it feels like, you know, anytime you say to a Brit, like, how are you going? And they're like, terrible. not bad is like spectacular for a pom, a Brit. If you're worried that there are difficulties in translating a survey across different countries, that would be another problem with my data here. Or if you thought there were different cultural meanings around what it meant to be satisfied with your data, all of those things mean that it's even harder to measure, that my measure of happiness might contain some truth, but also contains a lot of noise, right? And we know what happens when there's noise in data, that noise is going to drive my correlations down. So I think there are very good reasons to be worried that these data shouldn't be taken totally literally as being the levels of happiness across countries. But if you think that through, that actually suggests that what I'm doing here is I'm understating the degree of correlation between subjective well-being and levels of income. So I think the measurement issues are important. I think they're there. But I don't think that they mean that the research program is useless. So that's what we get when we look at cross countries. Let's move on. And let's think about now the part that's new, which is what happens within a country through time. And so what I want to do now, so what I've done so far is I've talked about really the initial work that Betsy and I did on this a few years ago. And we thought, wow, this will have some impact. And then people came back to us and they said, no, the Eastland paradox is all about what happens through time, within a country through time. As a country gets richer, does it get happier? And they've all said, oh, and every time I run that regression, I get statistically insignificant results. And if it's statistically insignificant, then we know that that must mean that there's no relationship, okay? So what I want to do, and the problem here is that it's very hard to find useful data because governments haven't been in the business of measuring happiness for very long. And if you want to make comparisons through time, the thing you need is data through time. And you need people to be measuring happiness way back when, before we even cared about happiness, right? So there's very scarce data. So the genesis for the rest of this research is basically very, very careful archival work where we're going to try and find literally every data set out there that we think can speak to the question we're after. And so no single piece of evidence is going to be persuasive, but what I hope to do is bludgeon you over the head with everything that's out there, and in some sense bore you to tears, which is I'm going to show you the same style of analysis 6 different times in 6 different data sets, and at some point you'll be bored. Hopefully they'll tell us something about what happens to happiness as within a country, or subjective well-being within a country as economic growth occurs. So let's go and do that. The question here is, do those countries that grow relatively faster or slower experience relatively faster or slower gains in well-being? So we're going to run regressions here of the form well-being within a country in a particular year as a function of the log of gross domestic product per capita in that, or average income in that country in that year. And then I'm going to control for which country we're talking about, country fixed effects. And so what that does is that means I'm controlling for all the cross-national differences that are persistent. So therefore, all of my analysis is going to be about what happens when a country gets richer through time. It's all going to be a temporal analysis. Now, the other thing I'm going to do, though, is I'm going to control for year or wave fixed effects. I'll say more about that in due course. That's basically the regression I'm going to run. Now, regressions are kind of boring. Here's the question. So I'm going to begin with the world value set. The World Value Survey is the most useful survey for what I'm doing because they've been surveying the most countries for the longest period of time, asking the consistent question. So this is where most people go shopping if they're trying to figure out what's going on through time with happiness. So we have either the life satisfaction question, how satisfied are you with your life as a whole, or taking all things together, would you say you're very happy, quite happy, not very happy, not happy at all? They've gone out and they've run this survey five different waves. Initially in 1981 through 84, they were out asking a bunch of countries. Then in the early 90s, the mid-90s, early noughties and mid-noughties. Now, there's a problem with these data that have led previous researchers astray. And this is, my partner says, the way of describing this, the lesson here is anytime you use data, read the code book. And it turns out that for many of these for some of these countries in the very early years, they found it very difficult to go and get a representative sample. So these were political scientists, and they were, for instance, going into China, and they couldn't find that it was very difficult to get a representative sampling frame. And in any case, political scientists are more interested in the opinions of elites than they are necessarily in what's going on in the broader cross section. So I think in China, for instance, the first time they went in, they just surveyed around the university in Beijing, I think it was. In India, when they went in, I think they initially surveyed only in Hindi, which is a language predominantly spoken by the rich, and later on added a whole bunch of other languages. So there are non-representative data early on in the sample. Why am I going to worry about this? They're non-representative in a very important way. Surveyors always find it easy to go in and find the elites and survey the elites, or political scientists prefer to do that. And so if you take these data seriously, what you get is in the early years in China and in India, they were surveying predominantly rich people, which means they were probably surveying predominantly happy people. And then what they did in later years, they said, oh, this non-representative surveying business, that's a terrible idea. Let's go and survey everyone. Well, now they went from China, from surveying around the university, to surveying in the whole country. When you do that, you get a lot more poor people and a lot more unhappy people. So think about what the measure is going to look like. It's going to look like happiness was high, because you're only talking to the happy people, and then happiness was low, and then you'll infer wrongly that through a period of economic growth in China, that people got less happy. So this is a deep and I think very difficult problem. So what we're going to do is actually just drop any data that come from a non-representative sample. There's no way to make a non-representative. You can't re-weight those Chinese data to make them representative of China, for instance. Okay, so now I just want to do one very quick statistical aside, and then it will make the rest of the talk go a little easier. So I'm going to show you regressions. Remember the regression I'm going to show you this regression, right? But regressions are kind of boring. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you graphs instead. But I want to show you that the graph and the regression are the same thing. So this is the regression we want to run. Well-being is a function of log GDP with wave and country fixed effects. And I could just show you the betas. And that's what we normally do. But this is literally equivalent to doing something else, which is we can take well-being and run a regression of well-being on country and wave fixed effects and take what's left over, the residual, and then we'll call that, the useful part of well-being, and then we'll do the same for log of GDP, and then we take the residuals and we pluck those residuals off, and then we can actually just draw a graph, and the graph on the horizontal axis is going to be income conditional on the controls, so it's the residuals, and on the vertical axis it'll be well-being conditional on the controls, so it's the residuals. And that graph, the coefficient you get from running this is literally what you get from the line of best fit on this scatter plot. And the reason I like doing things this way is instead of just showing you regression coefficient, I can show you scatter plots, and then you get to see, does it really look like the data are particularly persuasive here? Okay. Hopefully that's not, it's not hard, but hopefully it's transparent enough if you know what I'm doing. Are there any questions on this? Good, you've all been well taught. Okay, so here's arguably the most important thing I'm going to say. Remember I began by doing comparisons between countries, comparing average level of happiness and the average level of GDP? That's what I'm showing here. And now I'm saying relative to the controls, okay? Average level of GDP, average level of happiness. I'm showing you this for the World Value Survey. And you can see a really powerful relationship. I already showed you that, okay? What we're interested in now, though, is controlling for wave and year fixed effects and looking at what happens through time, okay? So when I do that, this is what the scatter plot looks like. And I've done something quite consciously here. I put them on the same scale. And the reason I've done that is so that you can see it's going to be really, really easy for the computer to figure out whether rich countries are happy and poor countries. And the reason it's really, really easy is because I got some wildly rich countries like the United States and some wildly poor countries like Burundi. And when you've got really big, sharp contrast to make, the data speak loudly. Okay. The problem, though, is when I'm trying to figure out if a country, as countries get richer through time, do they get happier? Well, what I can do is I can compare, you know, these poor guys, these are the guys who don't grow very much, you know, it's probably like Argentina, with the guys who grow a whole heck of a lot, that's kind of like Korea, maybe, okay? And they'll be over here. But the thing is, the differences just aren't that sharp. Because I've only got data back to 1981, so even, you know, comparing the relative success of Korea and the relative failure of Argentina, they're nothing compared to the differences between the US and Burundi, okay? So this is, when I began this project, I actually thought this graph would be the whole game, which is the point here is to say, of course, when people run regressions, looking at the time series variation this side, they find statistically insignificant results. Because when there's no variation in the thing you're after, or not much variation, then results turn out to be statistically insignificant. Now, of course, we should all remember the absence of evidence for propositions should never be confused as evidence of its absence, which is to say the fact that people had run regressions looking at as countries get richer through time, do they get happier, and found statistically insignificant results, does not by any means tell us that they didn't, that we know they didn't get happier. What it tells us is it's a really darn hard question to answer because the standard errors are so damn big, right? So, I think that is the, so this is why the cross-country comparison is going to be easy to make. We had some pretty strong results. I got a, you know, here I got a t-set of like 7. But the within country through time results, it's going to be a lot harder. And so one view is already what you know is anyone who tells you they know for sure that this is a zero relationship has got to be kidding because there's not enough variation to be sure of anything. Okay. So then the second thing I did was I really held my breath and I was like, well, I'm going to be courageous and I'm going to hit regress on the computer and let it decide what the line of best fit is. And it turns out it's this line of best fit right here. It may not be super obvious, and that's fine, right? But the coefficient here is actually 0.54, which, because I'm sloppy, I'm going to say is awfully close to 0.35. But I'm not being sloppy in saying it's not zero, right? In fact, I've got a t-statistic here of about 7. So people who say, look at these data and say, you know, it looks, we're pretty confident that the coefficient here is zero, I'm happy with one of two views. Either we shouldn't be confident of anything because you don't find this scatter plot convincing, and I think that's okay, or we should actually believe what the scatter plot tells us, which is it looks like, if anything, higher economic growth is in fact correlated with higher growth and well-being. So let's now, for what I'm going to do for the rest of it, I'm going to move off making these comparable scales here. I'm going to zoom in so we can actually see what's going on. So this is what that crazy little set of dots look like when we make them big dots instead. And so you see exactly what I said a moment ago, which is the coefficient here is positive. It's about the size that we were expecting. And the data don't fully cooperate. These aren't lining up right along the regression line the way we saw before. There's a huge amount of noise here, but there's a huge amount of noise because there's a lot of other things going on in these countries as well. Now that's looking at life satisfaction from the World Value Survey. The World Value Survey also asks about happiness. And this is one of those things where, so my coefficient is 0.16, that's smaller than 0.35. Standard error is 0.10. So if you're really kind of easy to convince, you call that statistically significant. But if you're not, then you're looking for the evidence to be a little stronger. But equally, I think the right interpretation of these data are to say they're so noisy, they don't falsify much that's very interesting. Right, so it looks like the data could be slightly positively sloped, they could be zero. They don't really speak particularly loudly. Okay, so that's the World Value Survey, and then what I want to do now is go on and bore you by doing the same analysis 5 more times. Okay. So hold on. So next is the International Social Survey Program. So this is when, if you ever worked with data from the General Social Survey, the General Social Survey is part of a broader network where these various countries go and ask the same questions sometimes. So they ask the question, and this, I should say, is a question that asks about happiness. How happy or unhappy are you? They've asked this question in 91, 98, 2001, 2007, 2008. We've got 39 countries. You know, and some countries are in some years, and some countries are in the other years, and so on. And so the horizontal axis here is GDP per capita, once we're controlled for country and year fixed effects. And the vertical axis is well-being, once we're controlled for country and year fixed effects. And again, here, we get a coefficient of about 0.55 with a standard error of 0.17, so you can't say that that's statistically different from 0.35. You can say it's statistically different from zero. Okay. And again, I don't think the data are super, when you just look at the dots, I don't think they're super convincing, but at least they don't scream at you, it's definitely zero, it's definitely zero. Let's move on to the Gallup World Poll. That was the one I began by saying I was really excited about. the Gallup World Poll is great for doing comparisons of rich countries and poor countries, because I've got lots of countries, right? I've got 141 countries. I've got really rich countries and really poor countries. But it's less good for what we're doing now, which is looking at countries through time, because it's only been running since 2008. So I've only got a very short time period, but I've got that very short time period 140 times. So I decided what I do is just throw all the data in, and we'll see how informative it is. And so this is the satisfaction ladder. Let me actually also add something. As I'm going through these six data sets, now I'm keeping them all on the same scale as each other, okay? So when you saw this one, and it's kind of convincing. That's because within the World Value Survey, it's been running for a long time. So there are some really, you know, Korea is really doing pretty well over here. And I'm not sure who this No Hoper is. I think it's one of the former Eastern Bloc, probably. But you know, you get quite a big spread. When you move this survey, it's only been running since 2008. The difference between doing great and terrible in the period since 2008 is pretty small, so the dots are all compressed, right? But even so, we get a statistically significant positive correlation, so we can reject zero, we can't reject 0.35. There's an important data set in Europe called the Eurobarometer. It's run by the European Commission. Every time a country joins the European Union, they get added to the data set. So it began way back when, in 73, with 9 countries, and today, my last data point, I think I have 31, and I think I have to add a couple if I was going to update another few years. And I don't know why, because I can't spell block. This is us about life satisfaction. And again, so because it's been running quite a long time, we've actually got quite a nice spread here, but the data are super noisy. And I can tell you one of the reasons the data are super noisy here is that the way they ask the question changed. They always ask the same question, but they change the order in which they ask the questions. So, and it turns out that really matters. So if you say to someone, are you totally bummed out about high oil prices? And then you say, how happy are you? Now, this data, they've been collecting data twice a year for, 40 years. So in some sense, you sort of hope those things just average out over 40 years. But so it's quite noisy. But again, you see a statistically significant effect here. Coefficient of 0.17, standard of 0.05. It's smaller than I was seeing elsewhere, though. Okay. Then, because I'm going to use all the data I got, we're going to go to the European Social Survey, which has been running since 2002, 28 countries. And you can see, because it's only been running since 2002, all the data are squashed back together, because most of these countries have had a fairly similar economic experience since 2002. But even so, when I ask the computer, does it look like these are positively correlated, it says yes. The coefficient is 0.86, very high standard error, so I wouldn't take the 0.86 literally. But it certainly doesn't look like zero, or strong evidence for zero. Pew have been going around the world. They have something called the Global Attitudes Study, where they go into a bunch of countries and ask them a bunch of questions, including about the satisfaction ladder. They've gone in 2002, 2007, 2010. One of the nice things is they go into quite a lot of countries. So we've got 39 countries here. And you can see, again, we get a coefficient here that I think is barely statistically significant, but it looks like you still can't reject 0.35, and you can maybe, at the margin, reject it at zero. Okay. And the final one is the Latin Barometer. So this is when they go into a bunch of Latin American countries and ask them a bunch of questions, including some about subjective well-being. Unfortunately, because it's Latin American, every second year they decide to change the questions. So I have to throw out the data whenever they do that. So I only have consistent data since 2001. But even so, when I do this, and actually the good thing about Latin America is it's a little bit crazy, so I get a little bit more spread than I otherwise would. When I do this, I get a coefficient now of 0.52, again, not statistically different from 0.35. So I think, again, you could look at this and you could say, these data aren't super convincing, but if they say anything, they seem to suggest that the relationship here is positive, and there's no sense in which I could look at these data and be convinced that the relationship is zero. So where have we just been? We've been looking at six pictures. Let me show you all six all at the same time. The point that I would emphasize here is in all six cases, in no individual case are the data convincing, but, although one might say the world data is somewhat convincing, but in no case does it look like the slope is zero. And in fact, in each and every case, the slope is awfully close to 0.35. So what we're doing here is we're just in the business of trying to extract whatever meaning we can from horrible, noisy, insufficient, incomplete data. But at the very least, it looks like those data don't falsify the view that I started with, which is that the slope would be around about 0.35. So, one question one might ask here is, you know, so what? What is it that drives GDP going up and down? So there's a separate thing that we do know, and we've known for a long time, which is that business cycles actually have really big effects on happiness. Unemployment drives happiness down way beyond what you would expect given the losses in income. Okay, and I think that sort of intuitively makes some sense. And so maybe what I was picking up was the ups and downs of GDP were just the ups and downs of the business cycle rather than which countries grew fast and which countries grew slowly. And so the way to figure out what's going on here is sort of to redo our whole analysis, but instead of putting average income or gross domestic product as our independent variable, to put trend or gross domestic product, or alternatively to control for unemployment and inflation. And so we go ahead and we do that, and it turns out it changes none of our conclusions. That was quick, huh? because it didn't control anything. It didn't change anything. You can stare at it if you want. But it doesn't change any conclusions. So another way of getting at this is, you know, if the question here really is what happens when, you know, countries really succeed in growth, that's in a long run sense, versus those that fail, a different way of doing this would be to say, you know, what happens over long periods of time between when one country grows a lot, how much does its happiness grow? Another country doesn't grow very much, how much does its happiness grow or fall? So this is long differences. There's some stuff I'm not going to worry about. So here's the data on the 9 European countries that were there at the beginning of the EU. And what I'm showing on the horizontal axis is GDP per capita. The vertical axis is well-being, once again. The solid circles are the circles that were available back when Easterlin did some of his reanalysis of these data in the 1980s. And the hollow circles are the more recent data that I've been able to update things with. And so, you know, as these countries are getting richer, are they getting happier? Which is another way. That's the question here. Now, the question there then is the slope here positive? And you can see in 8 of the 9 cases here, as these countries got richer, it looks like they became more satisfied with their lives. There is actually one really interesting open question here, which is, what the hell's wrong with Belgium? It turns out you make life better for them, and they get more miserable. Now, I think I'm not for a moment saying the only thing that shapes well-being within a country is economic development, gross domestic product, or income. There are, in fact, other things going on with the Belgians. They all hate each other, and maybe that's part of what's going on there. But at the very least, if my story gets 8 out of 9 right, I feel okay with that. Okay, so then let's try and do a similar analysis using the World Values Survey. Let me tell you the difficulty that I have. So in the World Values Survey, they survey countries in 81, in the mid-90s, late 90s, early noughties, mid to late noughties. And you would think that, well, what you could do is just look at, you know, the first time a country's in the data and the last time is just look at the change in happiness and then look at the corresponding change in GDP. But there's a problem, which is between the second and the third waves of the World Values Survey, they changed the ordering of the questions. And they changed it in a very important way. It used to be that they just sort of said, you know, how satisfied are you with your life? And people go, oh, pretty satisfied. Then what they did is they changed the question, and then 5 questions later they'd ask them how satisfied they were with their finances. So what they did in the third wave is they changed the ordering. And so they'd say, how satisfied are you with your finances? We're all sort of unhappy about that, right? And then the very next question was, how satisfied are you with your life? And if you looked at the data, it looked like there was a global happiness depression, right? Because all of a sudden the average levels of happiness went right down. The other thing that happened when they did that is the correlation between these two measures went way up, which is, again, exactly what you'd expect. When you prime someone on a particular domain, they think a lot about that domain. And so what that means is you can't actually compare the absolute levels of happiness before and after, okay? But what you could do is you could say, what about those countries? What you could do is you could say, well, how much did happiness grow in the US over that period, and how much did it grow in Italy over that period, for instance, right? And then you'd have the same survey effect distorting both of those changes. So the difference between those two would be okay, right? So then what I need to do is I need to make sure that I'm comparing I only make comparisons between the same 2 surveys, right? So that's what this graph is all about. So this is all the countries who were surveyed the first time and all the countries that were surveyed the last time. let's look at, for that set of countries, how much did your GDP grow between 82 and 2005? So the Koreans are going gangbusters, 150%, you beauty. South Africa and Mexico, nothing happened. And then the vertical axis is how what was the change in subjective well-being, right? And the thing I was talking about, this global depression that happened in the middle of all this, it's going to push everyone's dots down, but we hope it's going to push them all down by the same amount, right? And so then we're still okay looking at the regression line here, okay? And so, you know, it does look like the countries that grew the most got the biggest bump in happiness, but equally, that's what the regression line tells us, but equally, and it's barely statistically significant, although it is awfully close to 0.35. Equally, it's not super convincing, right? But, you know, that's the best evidence we got. So then I can, and the good thing about this is the longest comparison I can do. So then let's come back and we can do like a different comparison. What about if you're in the first wave and the fourth wave? And this is the full set of countries that were in those two waves. And again, you see quite a strong positive relationship here. Or you could do it between what about the second wave and the last wave? And this actually, it looks flat, it's actually slightly negative. So this is the second time I've shown you a negative relationship. But I want you to look at the standard error on that. The standard error is 0.27. So if I thought that the underlying truth was 0.35, this doesn't falsify that at all. What we're learning here is when you're doing comparisons between the second and the last wave, the data are hopelessly uninformative and they falsify nothing. And we can do the same for, like, you know, the first and the third wave, the second and the fourth wave, and you can do all these different comparisons, right? But over across all of these, it looks like when the data have enough precision to speak, they seem to be suggesting, again, a positive relationship. And we can do a similar thing for three of the other data sets. And again, for three of the other data sets here, I'm comparing the first and the last observation once I've adjusted the country in way of fixed effects. You can see for the World Value Survey, I get a coefficient of 0.45. For the Eurobarometer, I get a coefficient of 0.07, but I get a standard error here of 0.24. What that's telling us is for most of the European countries, because most of them grew by about the same amount over this period, there's not a lot of variation, so the data are quite uninformative. And the other two, you see a similar pattern again. Okay, so that's what happens when we look at these long differences. So the structure of the talk so far has been as follows. What I've done is I've said, here's a question I'm going to ask it in this data set. I'm going to ask it in this data set, and this data set. Right? And I think that somehow all those data sets combined can speak more clearly than just looking at one of them. Well, the thing I could do instead is, what do we learn from all of them at the same time, right? So what I've done, so what I can do is instead of thinking about these as six separate data sets, I can stack them one on top of the other and then use all of the available information I have across all of these data sets at the same time. Saying it another way, what I've been doing so far is I've been looking at the relationship between well-being in a country at a time with log GDP in a country at that point in time for each survey separately. So I've been reporting separate beta S's here to you each time, right? Well, that's literally equivalent to just running this regression, interacting everything with survey fixed effects, and just getting six different beta S's, right? Well, what we want to do is we're sort of interested in the average of the beta S's. So what we're going to do is just simplify this regression once and just say, no, there's just one beta that determines the relationship between all of them. So basically, this is a way of trying to get all six of those different data sets to speak to the same question at the same time. Now, this requires making more assumptions, and it's definitely a little bit more heroic, because it's saying, like, happiness data from one survey are in some sense comparable to satisfaction data from another survey. So there are reasons you would be suspicious of what I'm about to do, but I think the game here is there are limited data, and we want to try and extract as much meaning as we can, and sometimes that does mean having to be a little bit more courageous than you would otherwise want to be. So when we do this, we get now a coefficient of 0.33 and a standard error of 0.09. Okay, so I'm going to call that awfully close to 0.35, and it's certainly not zero. And then we can sort of fiddle with this, like, let's control for the state of the business cycle, let's control for inflation and unemployment, let's put them all in together, blah, blah, blah. And this coefficient always remains statistically significant, and it bounces about a bit, and it seems to get a little bit weaker sometimes, but it's always, you can't reject 0.35 in any case, and you can always reject zero. Okay. So let me tell you the last thing I'm going to do, which is kind of a fun thing. So what I've said to you so far is those countries, so all this says those countries that have grown the most have enjoyed the greatest bump in well-being. Well, the whole world has grown over the past 40 years. So a question would be, what's happened to the global happiness? So I'm going to try, and this again requires a little bit of courage and a bunch of assumptions, and estimate what's happened to global happiness over the past 40 years. Okay. And the way I'm going to do that, I've got my 6 different data sets. For each data set, I'm going to run a regression of well-being in that data set on country-fixed effects, because I don't want the different sample compositions of which countries are in and out of the sample to be messing things up, and then time-fixed effects. And the time-fixed effect I'm going to call like gross national happiness, or gross global happiness, average global happiness, as measured by that data set, right? And so this is what I get for the Eurobarometer. Well, you know, calling that global, it's only measuring Europe. As I said, this is going to require some assumptions, right? This is the World Value Survey, is it? Yes. And so on. So you can see all these and this one. And the first thing to note, you probably have to stand exactly where I'm seeing to stand. One thing is, you shouldn't take the differences in the levels seriously. That's just, I've separated them so that you can see them, okay? But if you stand at this angle, you can actually see that all of them are sloping up. Although you may not be impressed by how much they're sloping up. But that's a question of how much I stretch out my y-axis. There's one that's not. The one that's not is the Gallup World Poll. This is the survey that began in 2006. What happened to the world in the years following 2006? There was the global financial crisis, of course. Many of these countries became poorer, many became more miserable. So I'm not at all surprised that the average levels of happiness as measured by the Gallup World Poll actually declined during a period of global recession. So I look at this and I say, wow, in all but one case, when I look at a data set, what's happening through time is I find rising average levels of happiness. So what I'm going to do now is try and combine all that data together. So this is a complicated graph, or it's an ugly graph. But so what I did is I ran a regression of well-being on year-fixed effects and country-fixed effects to control for, you know, who's in the sample. And also I controlled for which survey it came from, because these surveys are on different scales and stuff like that, right? But the year-fixed effects, I'm going to call average happiness in the world. Although, to be clear, it's actually average happiness in the sample of countries for which I can measure happiness. Okay, and I shouldn't call it happiness, it's satisfaction. Well, actually, it varies. Some satisfaction, some happiness. And that's what the blue dots are, right? So that's my first rough estimate of global happiness through time. And if you look at this now, it looks like global happiness has actually risen through time. The blue dots today are a little bit higher than they were back then. And I fit a line of best fit. That's the dashed line through all of this. Okay. So then the comparison I made is I then did the same analysis for GDP, which is to say I ran a regression of GDP on country for every country year cell for which I can measure happiness. I take the corresponding level of GDP, and then I run a regression of GDP on country in the year fixed effects. So that says then the year fixed effects I'm going to interpret as the average level of GDP per capita, or the change in that through time, for the sample of countries for which I can measure happiness. Okay? And so this says, for the countries and observations that went into the blue dots, this is what happened to global GDP. And then I'm going to do one trick in how I'm going to scale it. Remember, I think GDP translates into happiness with a coefficient of 0.35, because that's the universal constant. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to take my estimate of what happened to global GDP for this universe, multiply by 0.35, and that's actually what the red line is. Okay? So the fact that the red line rises at about... So things to notice here. The dashed line I take, the blue dots and the dashed line jointly tell us the world is getting happier. And the fact that the red line seems to rise at about the same rate as the dashed line says the world is getting happier pretty much at the rate I would expect given the rate at which the world is getting richer. Okay? So that's that. Let me blow through this. And there was meant to be a stop. So, you know, what do we conclude from this? I say from international panel data, it does look like the countries that grew the fastest experienced the biggest bump in happiness. When we looked at the long differences, the larger the rise in well-being, the larger the rise in GDP, the larger the rise in well-being. And while no single piece of evidence is persuasive, I look at this as a pastiche of evidence, which seems to suggest that raising the incomes of all does, in fact, raise the well-being of all. And also, I get to say that global well-being rose over the past 4 decades, and I think it rose roughly at the rate you would expect given what happened to the global economy. So coming back to, you know, this whole thing, what I hope to have shown you is that richer people are happier than poorer people, and we think the coefficient on that gradient is about 0.35. In roughly equal measure, rich countries are happier than poor countries. In roughly equal measure, as countries got richer, they got happier. And in roughly equal measure, when you do these cross-country through time comparisons, you get the same thing. So the point that I make then, or the conclusion that I draw, is there is no Eastland paradox. There never was an Eastland paradox. It's deeply interesting to theorize about it, but it turns out we'd be theorizing about a set of facts that aren't true. Let me stop there.